Hey, people, what is up? Well, in this video, oh God, Exacto, quit talking about the same damn knives. Calm down. I'm not going to discuss these specifically. What I am going to do in this video is I'm going to discuss some anatomy. Okay, Exacto, talk about the knives then. Just don't talk about your dick or any of your wife's parts. Hold on, I'm talking about the anatomy of knives. I was talking to a couple of friends, and one of them specifically knows what I'm about to do here. And I thought it would be a good idea for some of the people that really may just be getting into it or just don't know some of the nomenclature, some of the terms we use, some of the parts and pieces, and this and that and the other. I thought it would be a good idea to actually go over what I know and kind of do a knives for noobs kind of deal. You know, just cover some of the basics. Now, I know for some of you collectors, some of you enthusiasts, y'all are going to be like, we already know this shit, Exacto. Why don't you show something else? But for the people that could use this information, it may be very valuable. I don't know. This video could go one of two ways. Either I could get a bunch of comments saying, Exacto, you suck. This video sucks. We already know all this shit. Or I could get videos saying, great, do more. And what I mean by do more is, if y'all like this kind of thing, I'll get into more detail. I'll pretty much start, you know, at the ABCs, and we'll work our way up to algebraic equations, so to speak. Or, to put that more simply, we'll start at the A and end at the Z. How about that? Either way, we'll see how it goes. Let's get into it. I got a variety of knives here at my disposal, and I'm just going to kind of jump around and start rambling. There's no structure to this. I don't script any of it. It just comes out as it comes out. Sometimes that's a good thing. Sometimes that's a bad thing. But either way you look at it, it's all real. All right, so first of all, we'll use this one. Just because she's high on my sugar list right now. Sweet thing, how you doing? But you got your basics, okay? You got your blade, y'all know that. Your handle, you know that. G10. G10 is a, it's kind of similar to a fiberglass. Basically, it's layers of shit smashed together, and it forms a really, a fairly impervious handle material. It's a basic handle material. You'll find it on a lot of knives, you know. Some people confuse it with a, hold on. Apparently, after all, I came ill-prepared. Sometimes people confuse it with a micarta, which can have a texture, or a G10 can be smooth. I'm getting ahead of myself, but either way, G10. Well, I'll save all the specifics for the, additional videos, because I have an engineer's mind, so sometimes I just go a little bit too far into things. Keep it simple. Okay, so blade, handle, liners. That part right there that's under that black part, that's the liner. That's what is responsible for your rigidity of the G10, because G10 can sometimes crack. And again, carried away. Lock bar. This is a frame lock. This particular style of lock, that's whenever you have your frame that jumps over and locks your knife. That's a frame lock. Also sometimes referred to as the Reeves integral lock, seeing as how he's the one that designed the damn thing. And if you're somebody like, I don't know, Benchmade, you might say it's the monolock. It's the same thing. It's a monolock. It's a frame lock. Now, sometimes you get frame locks that look like liner locks because they got a slab of something over them. This one sort of does. Some of them have a whole slab going all the way up, but you can kind of tell the difference. A liner lock and a frame lock. Here's a liner lock. That is to say, the liner actually locks the knife. You got a whole slab of something here with a liner inside that locks the knife. That's a liner lock. This would be a frame lock, even though it does have partial G10. Even if it had full G10, all the way to, like, say, you know, just covering it a little bit. Actually, again, see, I don't think of these things whenever, before I start the video. Here's a good example. Frame lock or liner lock? What do you think? Well, it has a whole slab of something, but, and what you have what appears to be a liner. It's part of the liner, right? Technically, you would say this is more of a frame lock, and the scale would be something that would allow you to not overextend your frame lock. It pretty much keeps the frame from going too far this way, which can damage your knife. Same thing as this little disc does for something without a scale over it. See? Keeps it from going too far. That would be called a lock stop, hinder, lock stop. You get a lot of, people call them all kind of things, but it's a lock stop or hyperextension prevention, you know. So, you got a lot of different things. Or actually, I'm on this one. Shit, getting carried away. So you got a lot of different variations on it. People get creative and they make different designs, but ultimately, there's your frame lock. That's how it looks. That's how it works. That would be the lock cutout. You can find that on the inside or the outside of the frame. People have their preferences. Okay. There's arguments over which one is stronger mechanically. I'm not going to go into the whole engineering thing. Believe me, I could, and some of y'all would be bored, but there's arguments over it, which one is structurally more sound, and I got my degree in structural mechanics and structural rigidity, so I have my preferences. I'll save it for the comments. Either way, and I'll get argued with. I don't care, you know, people will argue with a brick wall, y'all. Rambling, digressing. You got your pocket clip, pretty basic. These are your hardware. We call this the hardware. Some people call it the furniture. I do too. Sometimes I call this the furniture. You know, it's the stuff that's on the knife. The scale, the screws, you know, little stuff like that. Thumb studs. That would be called the furniture or the hardware. Or sometimes people just call them screws. Imagine that. So there you go. You got your pivot. Your pivot is basically the shaft that slides into the hole. And your blade rotates around it. That's your pivot. Pivot screw. Okay, loosening and tightening that pivot screw can adjust your blade play, your lock up, you know, different things like that. When you say blade play, that is to say, does it wiggle? When you hold the handle tight, does it wiggle? That's blade play. Let's talk about thumb studs. This is a thumb stud. You can have, well, here's a good example, a thumb hole. Somebody asked me the other day, what's that hole in the blade called on a Spyderco on one of my videos? And I said, well, that's the thumb hole. And those of you that have been around me know I am very fond of the hole to put my finger in. You like that, baby? So thumb hole, you can have just various opening methods. They got thumb discs. Again, must leave the viewing range, y'all. Hold on a minute. Looking for a thumb disc. Here we go. Good example. There's a thumb disc. It's a disc. Put your thumb on it. Opens the blade. So you can have different kind of opening methods. There's all kinds. I like the thumb stud on some knives, but generally, anytime I get a thumb hole, I'm going to prefer that over pretty much any thumb stud, thumb disc, whatever. That's my favorite. later on, if y'all want me to, in another video, I'll get into blade grinds, you know, different edge type things, stuff like that. But, you know, you got things like your swedge, and we'll cover that later if y'all like these. Right up here, that crap that sometimes works, sometimes doesn't. Those little notches cut in the blade, that's what we call jimping. Some have better than others. You see, this is really good. And that would be called a thumb ramp. Pretty straightforward there. It's a ramp. Put your thumb on it. So some are better than others. Some have none at all. Generally, not always, but generally, when you get a tighter pattern like this right here, if it'll focus, that tighter pattern would generally give you a little bit more purchase than something like this. And I call this scalloping. This is some of the nomenclature you may hear on my channel. Scalloping is what I call that. It's really rounded and it really don't give you a lot of bite. So that would be jimping or scalloping if you hear me say it, or texturing, whatever. I consider that part of the handle. It's on the blade, but I consider it part of the handle. These are all things you might pick up in my reviews. Obviously this right here, this hole, is a lanyard hole or whatever you want to stick in it. You know, you can stick whatever you want in there. Who am I to judge? But that's a lanyard hole. Back here in the back, these things right there, little pillars, those are called standoffs, or some people call them pillars or backspacers. You know, there's different kinds of names we put on them. But basically they serve to keep the knife apart and hold your knife together at the same time, right? Something like this would be a flow-through design or pillar construction. In other words, it has no backspacer running down it per se, like something like that is a solid backspacer, or something like the Manix would have solid right here and open back here, or even steel. There we go. Good example. There's one with a solid backspacer. You can't see through it. You know, it's pretty much closed up. Generally, also, as a rule of thumb, something like this is going to be much easier to clean than something like this. Because this one, you're going to have to go in from the underside there and clean it out or take it apart. This one, you can just get your Q-tip, damp it up with whatever you like, and go in there and clean. So it flow through. That's why you hear us refer to it as a flow through design, because all the crap is going to flow through it. You know, pillar construction, open construction, some people say, whatever. Oh, look at all these knives everywhere. It just keeps on adding up. And if I miss something, y'all, please put it in the comments. If I missed some kind of thing, say, hey, Exacto, don't forget about, and drop it down there, y'all. All information is welcome here. All right. You got your exotic stuff. Actually, let me cover this right quick. You got some of your old school, like the lock back or the mid lock, or some people call it a spine lock, whatever. I call it the lock back because it's, you know, a lock on the back. These have been around for a long time. Very similar to a slip joint, but you just don't have your hook. You know, I'll talk about slip joints maybe in another video. I don't have an example of one of those to go grab right now. Not my favorite stock of knives. I probably have one, but I'm not getting up again, damn it. Hopefully. I can't promise you anything, but either way, lock back. Some will be here. Some of the older ones you might see back here, like the Buck 110s, they might have the button back here, the lever where you push in. I like these better because you don't have to come all the way back here. You know, that's awkward. This, much easier to work with. Okay, tried and true design. I like lockbacks. Spine locks, mid locks, whatever you want to call them. And then you have your exotics. Something like the, I call them exotics. They're not really exotic, you know, like magic swiping locks where you would have to, like, put in a combination and swipe your finger a certain way. That'd be exotic. These are pretty known throughout the knife community, yet they're not some of your basics. This is your caged ball lock, Okay, some people call it the ball lock. There's been other names for it, but I call it the caged ball. And I believe that's what spider code refers to this one as too. Pretty simple, got a spring, got a ball. Ball jumps on the spine. I'll save that for the mechanics videos. If you want me to do mechanics on each one of these, I can do it. That's my specialty, y'all. The mechanics of things. But yeah, you got these. Then you got your access lock, which I don't own any of because, well, some of you know why. And don't ask me in the comments why. Go watch my Manx 2 video. You'll see why. Something like the compression lock, which some people call a reversed or an upside down liner lock. Works in the same type of way, but it really has a lot of differences that make it not necessarily like a liner lock. A liner lock is you've got a piece of steel or whatever. You've got a piece of something that jumps in behind that tang. This is a little bit more involved, the compression lock, in that you have a lock or a blade stop, which we'll talk about in just a minute. You have a blade stop, and you got your blade tang, and you got a U-shape in the blade tang, and then you got this little thing that looks like a finger or a penis, and it just kind of sandwiches in there and slides over, and basically, it's like a liner lock. Okay, without getting too crazy with it, I'll save that for the mechanics video. It's basically just a liner lock upside down. I can see what people mean. That's how it works. If you were to do it like this, you know, up under here, it'd be a liner lock. For all intents and purposes. Logistics, or excuse me, semantics notwithstanding. But then you have your others like the button lock. I happen to love the button locks. This one is an automatic button lock. It has a spring. The spring is under constant pressure. I could do videos on automatics too if you like. If you want to see automatic, you want me to talk about those. You know, all the different types specifically, individually, I could do that. But a button lock, some people think that your button lock is going to be an auto. Not necessarily. Not if it's under or not under spring pressure. This one is always biased toward open. When you release it, it always wants to be open. Okay? So as soon as you push the button and release it, it's ready to be open. Something like this one is manual all the way, but it's still a button lock. Works exactly the same as this one in the lockup. Same exact principle, but this one's never biased toward anything. This one's, you know, not biased at all. Something like your assisted openers, they're not biased until they get to a certain point. Like, see, it's not biased there. Now, when you get to about right there, then it becomes biased. When I let it go, you see. So that's an assisted. That's the difference between assisted and auto and manual. Assisted is biased at some point during the opening process. Automatic is always biased under constant pressure until you release it, and now it's not under pressure. No longer under pressure once it's open. You load it back up by doing that. Like I said, I'll save that for the video if y'all want me to do that. And a manual is never under any bias. It's not biased closed. It's not biased at any point throughout the opening, and it's not biased when it's, you know, at rest. Basically, it's manual. But my point was the button locks, they work identically. If you put a spring coil in this blade, you could push that and it would fire. I mean, well, this one's a little bit different because it has no hook. I take that back. I'll get more into that if I do the mechanics video, but this one has no hook to actually hook it closed. Whereas this one, you listen to it, it'll snap shut. See? So it has a hook, so to speak. Not actually a hook, but it has, you know, it keeps it held there with the mechanism. This one doesn't necessarily do that, but you know, you could make it do it if you wanted to. You can convert button locks into autos with a little bit of ingenuity. Man, I'm sorry, y'all. I know it's supposed to be simple, but I'm trying not to go too deep into it. What else did I want to cover? You got other things. This is the lock system. You know, you push that. You know what? I'll save that for the video that in which I cover it. I'm trying hard to keep it simple, y'all. My mind just don't work that way. This is a ballad song. This is extremely simple in its design, extremely reliable in its design. Been around a long time. One of my favorite, if not my favorite, type of folder. And it's just, man, I love them. Opens with a basic swing of each handle. Encapsulates the blade. Swing one handle. Swing the other handle. You've got a variety of methods in which you can keep the blade from doing this kind of number. Some Zen pins, like this one. Some Tang pins. Maybe I'll do a ballet video too for, you know, people that are interested. But basically, it's really fail-proof in that once your hand is wrapped around the handle, you need no lock. It's not going to close unless you actually have a mechanical function failure. That is to say, you shear your stop pins or your handles break or something like that. It's not going to fold on you because of a lock failure. And, of course, you know, they're just a real strong design. I happen to really love the belly. More on that if y'all want me to. This is just a trial type video. What are we at? 21 and some change. Now, I know I'm going to inevitably get the question, Exacto, what is your favorite type of lock? Honestly, frame lock. Now, again, I'll touch on this deeper. I'll try to resist, y'all. I'll get deeper into this. Oh, man, it just happens. I will cover this in more detail later. There we go. But when we're talking frame locks, you got a lot of specifics. You got titanium, you got steel, you got titanium with steel inserts or carbidizing or carburizing. You got different kinds of things that make one more desirable than the other depending on who you are and what you like. However, I just like frame locks. To be simple, I mean, there's all different kinds of things and I do have my preferences. But overall, as a whole, I like the frame lock. All my favorite knives are frame locks. This one has a steel insert. This one don't. Some are carbidized, later of tungsten. We'll go over it here, but something like a good frame or a liner lock, a good liner lock, that is to say, emphasis on good, will be just as strong as your frame lock. I know people dispute this, but I mean structurally, you got everything in its favor. This one has what they call the fail-safe liner. Of course, no folder is fail-safe. About the closest thing you can get to fail-safe in a folder is a ballad song. And if you want something that is fail-safe, get a fixed blade. Either way, digressing, rambling, standard, jumbling words, this and that and the other. So, I have no reason to believe that this Millie is any less strong than this Millie, simply due to the amount of material behind the tang. Well, yeah, but then you've got your frame pretty much holding that liner. Again, I will cover that later. Point is, I like a good frame lock. A good liner lock is good too. Of course, y'all know I like the lock back. Tried and true. Something like one of the Cold Steel Demco designs. Demco's Triad Lock. Damn good lock back. Super bad. Button lock. I love a good button lock. It's really the theme here. What I'm getting at, I guess, in way too much detail for this particular video, is if your knife is designed good, really it doesn't matter what kind of lock you have. Sure, certain locks are going to have certain characteristics, but all in all, if you've got a good lockup, if you've got a good design, good materials, your knife is going to be good. Okay, so all the little semantics and particulars about which does this and which is this and which is stronger and all that mumbo jumbo, that's all bullshit and better served for the forums, better served for people that have nothing better to do. Really, I don't get into all that. I could, but I don't. Basically, get a good knife, the knife will be good, regardless of what lock you pick. I'm trying to think. Did I cover everything? I covered pocket clip. Let's look at this one. Excuse me. Let's look at this one. This one has some things that are a little different. It has a flipper. Okay? When we talk about a flipper, that's what that is. And that's a method of deployment for this blade. You take it and you flip it. Makes sense, right? Flips it open. Becomes a finger guard. Okay? Some people call this a choil area, you know? That's a finger guard there. Some people call it, this is a little choil area, I guess you could say, a sharpening choil. See? It allows you to get your stone up on the blade without contacting a raised portion, like, I don't know, the biggest culprit, Paramilli, has none of that sharpening choil goodness right there, so while you're trying to sharpen on your stones, you're going to not be able to get to the very back unless you got a fine stone or, you know, adjust your technique, you know, but if you got a round stone, you might have an issue getting to the very back because of that lip, that choil area right there. That's the choil. And you see, it poses some kind of a hindrance at times. Something like this would allow you to get all of the blade sharpened. Something like this. I happen to prefer that, but either way, everything's workable. Everything that you can work around anything if you do use the right tools to do it. We talked about thumb studs. I almost forgot I was going to tell y'all about blade stops. Well, you got various kind of blade stops. In this particular knife and on the 500 here, the thumb studs nest up against that little area right there in the handles, TI side, G10 and steel side over here. These thumb studs come up there and they stop when they hit that. That's your blade stop. This right here that you see inside of there is not a blade stop. Well, it is a blade stop, but it's, you know, for whenever it goes this way, not for when it goes this way. Okay. See, this one right here, same deal. Now, that's not a blade stop for an open blade stop. Let's put it that way. In these particular knives, that's a closed blade stop. Some of them, like this one, that is a blade stop for whenever it's open. You see? Tang of the knife, I know it's not focused, damn you. Focus? Hello? Alright. The tang of the knife will go up there and hit that, and then stop. Let me get a better example of that. Something, maybe y'all can see this one. There we go. So whenever I open it, this part right here is going to come up there and set up against that little bar and stop the blade from going any farther up. Okay? Some blade stops act as blade open and closed stops. So that is to say they'll work here, and when you close the knife, it won't let it, you know, go up in the handle anymore. You got all different kinds of designs. We could be here all night talking about them. Of course, I'll answer any questions you want to know. Then you got actually blade stops that I really like. One of my favorite, in my opinion, one of the best blade stops you can get in a production knife here, or any knife really, is this kind. Now, it's going to be harder to see. Let me grab my light. Come on. Play nice, camera. See, right in there, you have a blade stop. Now, you notice that one's kind of weird in that it's octagonal. And what that allows you to do, each face is of a different, it's a little bit farther or closer. You know, it don't pivot on a perfect circle. It kind of pivots oblong, like I guess you could say, in an ovaloid fashion. Either way, as you twist that blade stop, whenever the blade tang comes and nests up against it, it'll lock up different. So maybe, this is exaggeration, but just bear with me. Maybe one way you do it, it locks up like that. Maybe one way it's like that. Maybe one way it's, you know, It changes what your blade does here. And if you change what your blade does this way, then you change what your blade or your lockup does this way. Okay, it's directly in relation to the, you know, they relate to each other directly. So that's very good. Basically, that blade stop, because it's octagonal, it allows you to adjust how your lockup is. That's ingenious. I love that. You can't do that on something like the Millie. I mean, there's tricks and stuff you could do. There's a bunch of tricks I could tell you later on that allow you to get, you know, a good centering. This one's perfect. I know some people say the Millies are not centered up well. I can get all my Millies centered up great, but there's a trick. I know, exacto, show the trick. I will, y'all. It's out there already, though. It's nothing I invented. So blade stops. That's blade stops. We talked about pocket clips, choils. I mean, the obvious things. But then again, this video is pointing out the obvious for people that don't know, right? There's your spine, blade spine. Okay. Some spines are crowned, which I don't think I have an example. Yeah, I do, actually. See how that's rounded? If it'll focus again, damn you. See the spine of this blade? Might be kind of hard to tell. Let me do it this way. It's rounded. That's called crowned. Some people just call it rounded. But, you know, that's always a nice touch. My little CRKT Ripple has that too. And that's a really affordable knife, so. I don't know, man. It's a long video. Trying to get a lot of information out here. Oh, detents. Let me see if I can get y'all a good example of that. Detent is the little ball that's on the underside, and you know what? Here's a good example. See right there, you got this little hole. Damn it, camera, if you don't cooperate with the focus, I'm going to trade you for a Panasonic. It's a Canon, y'all. It's better. Either way, I just got to threaten her sometimes, you know, because, hey, she listens. There's a hole. In that hole is a little ball, usually stainless steel, some are ceramic. Got, you know, only limited by the creator, but that basically holds your blade shut. So you can't do one of these things and shake it out. Some are stronger, some are weaker. And basically, it holds in a little dimple in the blade. The ball goes down in there. It keeps it firm. Then you break it free. And it, you know, kind of keeps tension on the blade. Sometimes if you look down in there, you can see a line. Come on. See that line right inside there, you can see a little line where it's cutting into the black coating. That's where the ball, that would be the arc. See that little silver line? That's the arc where the ball is cutting into the coating. That shows your track. Okay. Detent is responsible for that. It's also what's responsible for keeping the knife blade closed when it's closed up, and it's also very much what's responsible in your flipper knives, or any knife really, not just a flipper. It's what's responsible for how fast it can come out. This one has a good detent, so once you overcome it, you got a lot of pressure built up behind, you know, that push, so it's going to just pop out, because you're like, you know, your pressure building up, break free of the detent, and it flies out. So that's why you hear people saying a strong detent makes for a fast knife, you know. Something like this one. Got a real strong detent on it. Real good detent. So once you do this, you can hear it. See? That's when the ball is jumping into the hole. And because of that, you just give it a lot of pressure behind here. Build it up. Boom. All that pressure gets released in the way of the blade opening. So, there's that. Some knives don't have a ball detent, though. You know, some knives have some kind of mechanism, like the auto here, there's no ball detent in this one. It's held by a little hook system, basically. I won't get into it. Like I said, that's for a later video because we could be here for a while. But basically, whenever you move this button out of the way back there, it lets go of it. Lets go of the blade. Like the ball lets go of the blade on these kind. The button lets go of the blade, and then it comes out there. You know, a little bit different on something like this, too. Although the blade, the detent is, you know, the button is similar, but not the same. Something like the ball, or cage ball lock, your detent, you see how it moves? Your detent is the ball bearing that basically is responsible for lockup. Same thing with your axis locks. That's how they work. Not identical, but similar. In Balisongs, you know, of course, they have no detent. So, and these right here, no detent on a lockback, basically what it is. I mean, no ball detent, that is to say. It has a detent in that, you see how that lock bar raises up? See there? That's your detent. So they have a little bit more initial give than something like one of these, where you have no initial give. You can build it up, rocket that thing out there. These have a more of an initial give, and they start getting tough right around here. But you can still, you know, rocket them things open if you do it right. Point is, it's just a different mechanism. Still a detent, though. You know, like something like this, the detent would be all at once. You know, detent's holding, then it lets go. And now there's no more detent. Something like this is, you know, not much detent. Detent starts picking up. You see when that raises up, that's when the detent is active. This is the detent. And it remains active throughout all the blade until you lock it up. So the detent carries through the whole opening. I don't know, just a little 101 here, a little basic stuff. I mean, some of you may find this incredibly boring. And if you do, then, hey, it's not for you. Go somewhere else. This is for the people that want to know what, you know, just basic stuff. Trying to be helpful, y'all. Trying to resist my usual crazy kind of videos. But yeah, I think I've pretty much covered most of the basics. I can't really think right now of anything else I would want to cover. But maybe something like this. You see there's no liners. I mean, there's liners all in there. You can see them. The silver, those are liners. But they're called nested liners in that they're set into the G10. There's, you know, milled portions of the G10, and the liners are set into it. So you really don't see them from above here. It just appears to be solid G10. There's steel liners in there. Then you got certain knives, which Cold Steel does this, and, you know, a few others. But you got solid G10 with no liners. Then you got knives with liners that are exposed, like this one. The G10 is just sitting over top of the liner. It's not nested. So if you hear somebody saying a nested liner, that's not this. That's like this. So there's a little bit more info I remembered there. Yeah, man, I mean, you know what? I could go on and on, probably. And I'll just save other stuff I remember for other videos. But if you have a term that you're wondering about, if you're watching this video and you're wondering about a term that you might have heard but you don't quite know what is, do not be ashamed to ask that down in the comments, because the only stupid question that you can ask is the one that you don't ask. You know, the only stupid question is the one not asked, is what I'm saying. That's how you learn, by asking questions. So, you know, not that I'm an expert or that I know everything about everything, but I know a little bit about a little bit, and I like to try to share that with people sometimes. That's what this is. So I'm going to go ahead and try to keep this thing under 40 minutes. How about that? Or right at. So with that, y'all, I guess I'm going to get on out of here. Let me know what y'all think about this. Hopefully it's helpful for somebody. I'll talk to y'all later. Life is short. Stay sharp.